Hello everyone, I am Dr. Neelam Chajer, consultant in fetal medicine at the New Life Fetal Medicine and Therapy Center, Nagpur. I welcome you all for this presentation on the first trimester scan, What Must an Obstetrician See? This is an NOJS e-Pathshala initiative. The objectives of a first trimester scan are screening for fetal aneuploidies, diagnosis of fetal structural abnormalities, screening for preeclampsia, prediction of preterm delivery and prediction of complication in twins. When and what to screen with? So usually this scan is performed when the CRL is between 45 to 84 mm and the gestational age is between 11 to 13 weeks and 6 days. It is performed by using a combination of both transabdominal and transvaginal probe as appropriate. So coming to the first objective, which is screening for fetal aneuploidies, there are 5 things on ultrasound that we look for while screening for aneuploidies. First one is the nuchal translucency that we all are familiar with, and the 3 soft markers such as nasal bone, tricuspid regurgitation and ductus venosus. Intracranial translucency is a soft marker for open neural tube defect. Few important concepts about NT. NT is a function of CRL and hence an accurate CRL measurement is extremely important. It increases with increasing CRL and it is considered high if it is more than the 95th centile for a given CRL. Invasive testing should be recommended if the absolute value is beyond the cutoff of 3 mm regardless of the serum biochemistry. An increased NT usually resolves after 14 weeks. However, in some cases, it can further evolve to nuchal edema, cystic hygroma or fetal hydrops. So coming to the protocol for measurement of NT. This is a very standardized protocol developed over a period of decade now. It was first devised by Professor Kiparos Nikolaidis, and there are now procedures and mechanisms in place whereby we can audit our practices and standardize our measurements. So the first and the foremost thing is the gestational age, which should be between 11 to 13 weeks, 6 days. The CRL should be between 45 to 84 mm. The magnification should be such that only the fetal head and thorax is visible. A mid-sagittal view of the face with neutral position, which means there should be some amount of fluid between the chin and the thorax. And then NT, which is the hypoechoic space between these two lines, these two white lines, is measured on its widest part from inner to inner diameter, and that defines our NT. Also in this section, we look for the nasal bone, and the nasal bone is seen as a three-line sign, this echogenicity being the tip of the nose, this is the overlying skin, and this is the nasal bone. At any point in time, the echogenicity of nasal bone should be more than that of the overlying skin to be called as present nasal bone. Coming to the next one, which is the protocol for assessment of ductus venosus. Again, the magnification should be such that only the thorax and abdomen of the fetus are visible. We should be able to see the umbilical vein, aorta and the ductus venosus. The sample volume should be small and the sweep speed should be high. So normally this is the type of triphasic waveform we should be able to see without any flow below the baseline. When we see a flow below the baseline between two waveforms, this is called as A wave reversal and it is a marker for aneuploidies. Coming to the protocol for assessment of tricuspid regurgitation, we should get an apical four chamber, magnified apical four chamber view. The Doppler sample volume should be between 2 mm to 3 mm to include all the cusps of the tricuspid valve. The sweep speed should be high and then we should interrogate the tricuspid valve. If we are able to get velocity scales which are more than 60 cm per second below the baseline and which cover more than half of the systole, then we say that tricuspid regurgitation is present and it is again a marker for aneuploidies. Coming to the intracranial translucency, in the mid-sagittal section, we are able to see 4 echogenic lines, 1, 2, 3 and 4, and 3 hypoechoic areas, 1, 2 and 3. These correspond to the brainstem, the intracranial translucency and the cisterna magna. So what is done is measurement of brainstem to brainstem angle, brainstem to occipital bone angle, which gives us prediction for presence of open neural tube defect. So this angle is depicted by the yellow line. So this is the brainstem and this is the distance between brainstem to the occipital bone. And the ratio of this should be always less than 0.9 to call it as normal. If it exceeds more than 1, then usually presence of an open neural tube defect is suspected because the brainstem gets thickened and pushed posteriorly into the posterior fossa. Coming to the second objective, which is diagnosis of fetal abnormalities. So we need about a dozen sections and one sweep to detect all the anomalies that we possibly can during our first trimester. There are a few anomalies that are always detected in the first trimester scan, such as anencephaly, A-lobar holoprosencephaly, abdominal wall defect, megacystitis and absence of limbs. There are a few that will be potentially detectable, such as diaphragmatic hernia, tracheoesophageal fistula, cardiac anomalies such as hypoplastic left heart. And there are a few that will be undetectable on this scan, such as microcephaly, cerebellar hypoplasia, agenesis of corpus callosum and renal abnormalities. So we will go through each of these sections systematically to know how we can identify anomalies at the first trimester scan. There is one sweep which is very useful in which we try to see the baby from head to toe and gives a very good overview of the fetal anatomy. So let us go through the sweep. So we can see the midline fax, the calvarium, both the orbits, retronasal triangle, mandibular gap, both upper limbs, four chamber heart, stomach, cord insertion and lower limbs. And this sweep is just 12 seconds. So literally in 10 to 12 seconds, you can see the fetus from top to bottom and make a judgment in your mind whether this baby looks normal or there could be a possibility of a problem. Coming to the individual section, this is one section of the head that gives us a lot of idea, especially the intactness of calvarium, which gives us an idea about presence of anomalies such as anencephaly, which has a universally poor prognosis and termination will be indicated. Also, it gives us an idea about the acrania exencephaly sequence. In this same section, we are able to see the midline fax and the two choroid plexus, which form the butterfly sign, which is seen like this. And if this sign is present, then we can practically rule out A-lobar holoprosencephaly. So in A-lobar holoprosencephaly, we see a single ventricle which is non-cleaved, C-shaped, and the thalami are fused. So it appears as a C-shaped monoventricle with fused thalami, and this indicates presence of a life-threatening condition called as holoprosencephaly. Coming to the next section, which is a little bit below in the posterior fossa, we try to see the intracranial translucency which we have previously discussed, and in this particular image we can see only one hypoechoic area which is thickened brainstem, and we are unable to see the fourth ventricle which is obliterated and the cisterna magna which is obliterated. Corresponding section of the spine reveals a neural tube defect, and this is another open neural tube defect. Sometimes we may be able to identify banana shaped cerebellum and an open neural tube defect on the lumbosacral spine. Then in the same mid sagittal section, if we get a normal alignment like this with the chin, with a fluid between chin and thorax and head in the neutral position, we can rule out anomalies such as eniencephaly, which is the extension deformity of the neck of the fetus and is associated with kyphoscoliosis, abdominal wall defects and body stock anomaly. Coming further down a bit more into thorax of the baby, we should be able to identify a diaphragm which is seen as a hypoechoic line, and if we can see an intact diaphragm, it helps us in excluding congenital diaphragmatic hernia. And in presence of congenital diaphragmatic hernia in the thorax section, we see the stomach in the thorax and heart pushed to one corner, suggesting dextrocardia and presence of congenital diaphragmatic hernia, and this can also be picked up at very early stages with the current resolution of machines. Coming down further to the abdominal section, if we can identify and document a normal cord insertion, we can exclude anomalies such as omphalocele, exomphalos, which is a membrane cover defect of the herniated bowels, or gastroschisis, in which there is no membrane cover to the herniated bowel. So normal chord insertion will exclude both of these conditions. Then a section down further below the abdomen will be in the pelvis or the lower pelvis, and we can see two kidneys, a three vessel cord and bladder. If we can see all these three things, it reassures us and tells us that probably the fetal renal system is well and there is no potentially life threatening condition such as megacystitis, which is an indication for termination during the first trimester because it has a universally poor prognosis. So if the bladder measures more than 7 mm or if it is more than 10% of the CRL at any given gestation, then we suspect megacystitis. Coming to the final section, which is the extremities, we document both the hands if possible with open fingers if the baby is showing, and both the lower limbs. This helps us in excluding limb anomaly defects such as fused limb or mermaid limbs, and absence of limb segments such as absent femur, radial ray defect, or absence of fingers or digits such as oligodactyly or extra digits such as polydactyly. Coming to the third agenda, which is screening for preeclampsia. So this is done by measuring the uterine artery in the first trimester, and as far as possible we should try to measure it transvaginally for the clarity that we get. And any uterine artery, so mean uterine artery PI is taken, which is a combination of the right uterine and the left uterine, which is taken transvaginally. And if the mean uterine artery PI is more than 2.5 at 12 weeks, it suggests a high possibility of preeclampsia or uteroplacental insufficiency in future. And a very simple measure such as starting 150 mg aspirin at bedtime can reduce the incidence of preeclampsia to half just by doing a uterine artery Doppler screening at this stage. Coming to the fourth objective, which is prediction of preterm delivery in a pregnancy. This is done based on the cervical length measurement. Again, there is a standardized protocol for cervical length measurement. With an empty bladder, we insert the probe in the vagina in the anterior fornix. We try to avoid exerting undue pressure as this may artificially increase the length. Then we take a sagittal view as shown in this picture. Endocervical mucosa helps us in guiding the exact cervical location, and which can be sometimes confused with lower uterine segment. So the guiding factors are the external os, which is seen as a triangle here, and the internal os, which is seen as a V-shaped sign here. The calipers are placed from internal os to the external os, and a measurement is taken. And each examination should be performed over a period of 2 to 3 minutes to look at the dynamicity of the cervix in case there is a contraction or there is shortening of measurement. And a normal measurement should be more than 2.5 cm. Anything less than 2.5 cm increases the risk of preterm delivery less than 34 weeks. Coming to the final objective, which is the prediction of complication in twin gestation. As we all know, the single most determinant of complications in higher order multiple gestation is the chorionicity of the foetus. So dichorionic fetuses tend to have much lower rate of complication compared to monochorionic fetuses. Hence, it is of paramount importance that we determine the chorionicity. And how do we do that? We use the lambda sign and the T sign. So lambda sign is when there is a thick intertwin membrane or a membrane separating the twins with a tissue of placenta wedged between the membranes, and this is called as the lambda sign. Or when there is a very thin membrane with no wedge of placental tissue in between, suggesting a monochorionic pregnancy. So documentation of chorionicity is a must during the first trimester scan or the NT scan, because this is the most accurate time for determining chorionicity and making a lot of decisions such as those related to fetal reduction or assigning positions to the fetus for future references. Finally, the take home message. The 11 to 14 week scan or the first trimester scan is indeed a great window of opportunity, and it should comprise of NT, NB and the soft markers, but should not be just limited to them. A detailed anatomic survey should always be the focus, including screening for preeclampsia, preterm birth, and small for gestational age babies. Thank you for your attention and patient hearing.